Good morning, Cornerstone Church. Come on, let's get up to our feet. We're going to get started with some worship. We got a new song for you. Come on, let's put our hands together. Come on, hey. Come on, here we go. We sing. Let everything.
Praise the Lord.
together.
Oh, give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. And show us that's where the miracle starts. Beyond what I want, beyond what I see. The change for my world beginning in me. I'm wholly surrendered, Lord, do what you will in me. Just make me your vessel, this life as an offering.
Come on, we sing together.
You can have it all, God. You can have it all. You can have it all, God. You can have it all. You can have it all, God. You can have it all. You can have it all.
Come on, we sing humbly.
Humbly we come, boldly we sing.
Jesus Christ, the highest name, send us your power, light the flame.
lift this up to him.
And make me your vessel. This life has an offering. I'm holy, wholly surrendered. Lord, do what you will in me. And just make me your vessel. This life has an offering. You're so holy, Lord. You are so holy. A thousand generations falling down in worship. You sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all have gone before us, and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. 'Cause your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all.
All thrones.
Of all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above. If you walk in freedom, and if you bear his name, we'll sing the song forever to the Lamb. We'll sing the song forever and amen, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy. The greatest, your name stands above.
Come on, I want you to sing this. Above
all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above.
Come on, this is powerful. We sing this back to him.
Oh, your name is the highest, your name is the greatest.
Yeah.
our eyes closed right now. Right now in the song, he's talking about the King of Kings. He's above all throne, all position. Now, the question for you is, what's your relationship with that King of Kings? He said in the Bible, in the Word, that I give you my peace. I don't give you my peace as this world does, which is based on circumstances. No. He said that I gave you my peace. And when he said this, he was about to go to the cross and suffer the cruel death that anybody can suffer. But I imagine that I imagine right now that he was smiling when he said that. Now my question for you today is, what's your level of peace? The Bible says that he came to set the captive free. Is something controlling you today that is keeping this peace away from you? With our eyes closed, I want you to think about that. The least you can have as a believer in Jesus Christ is peace and joy, no matter what happened. Do you have that? Can people around you see that? At home, do you have that peace? And I can guarantee you, it's not God's will for you to be like that. Because he said, I give you my peace. Not as this world does. So everything that you have right now going on in your life that is keeping this peace from you, join me in prayer. You yourself, lift it up to God. He wants to set you free. The Bible says that whom the Son set free is free indeed. Not sometime. You are free and you are free. Whether you have money or not, you are free. Your mind is free. Your heart is free. Father, we thank you again this morning. Jesus, I thank you for your presence. Because there is no one like you, Lord Jesus. You are here tonight. And every demons, every confusion, everything bowed down before you. Because you are who you say you are. You are the I am. Whatever you step your feet, your step in, Father, I know that everything calmed down. Back in the days, when you went in the synagogue, the demons cry out and they left. Because they can't stand your light. But I write on the name of Jesus. I pray that you shine your light in our hearts today. In our mind. Everything that we are going through, Lord, I pray that you shine your light in the name of Jesus. Any confusion. Any abuse from the enemy. Any misunderstanding, Lord. In the name of Jesus. Because I know that it pains you when we go through things like this. Your will is for us to walk in freedom, like the song just said. Glorify your name tonight. The rest of the service is in your hand, Lord. Have your way. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you guys. Thanks for coming, okay? If this is your first time, thank for being bold to this place that you've never been to before. But some of you that are always here, I love this verse. Psalm 92 verse 13. The Bible says that those who plant themselves in the house of the Lord will flourish. I guarantee you, because you are here, Pastor Dave will share the word, you get something of it, and that will grow in you. Amen. God bless you. You can turn around and say hi to your people around you.
What is up, Cornerstone? Thank you so much for joining us for church today.
This is Cora, and my name is Marianne. If you are new here, we'd ask that you text the number that's on the screen to get connected with resources for you for the church. This coming weekend is daylight savings time, so don't forget to turn your clocks back 1 hour on Saturday night.
I can't wait to get an extra hour of sleep.
Actually, it doesn't matter for me because I have goats. They don't operate by a clock.
Cool. I do. The Pursuit Conference is happening on November 4th. It's a conference for young adults ages 18 to 30, and they're seeking to unify young people in our pursuit of Jesus. So join us at Faith Church in Austin for a day full of worship, speakers, and food. You can register on the Cornerstone app today.
Our youth students are serving a meal this weekend after the Saturday night service and after the 10:45 service. The money raised from these meals will all be going directly to Speed the Light, which is an organization that raises money for missionaries to spread the gospel around the world and to combat human trafficking. So if you are here this weekend, we ask that you please come out to support our youth students.
I love walking tacos.
Me too, they're the best.
It's after service, right?
Both services.
Perfect.
Saturday and Sunday.
Awesome. Can't wait.
Yeah.
We are having water baptism in all three services on the weekend of November 18th and 19th. If you're interested in taking this next step in your faith journey, or if you have any questions about water baptism, please attend the informational meeting after any of the services on the weekend of November 4th and 5th. This is a great opportunity to take the next step in your faith. Ladies, if you are watching this on Sunday morning, we wanted to remind you that Flannel Fest is happening tonight at 6 p.m.
There will be worship, devotions from people that you don't usually hear from in the church, s'mores, and just time to be together as women.
And I heard there's a few giveaways too.
Oh yes, I think there are.
All right, Marianne, this has been awfully fun, but right now it is time to get dialed.
Yes. Well, I am so glad that you're here. We're glad that you chose to join us this morning. My name is Corey. If you don't know me, I'm one of the pastors here. I'd love to get a chance to meet you. Catch me in the lobby afterwards. But we're glad that you're all here. And make sure that if you're wondering about any of that stuff, go right to the Cornerstone app. All the info is on there for you. Right now, we want to take just a moment and prepare our hearts to give in this weekend's tithes and offerings. If you have something you'd like to give here in person, there are giving stations on the back wall. There's one by the Info Center as well. You can give through the Cornerstone app also. And so we're very grateful for your continued faithfulness to God through the ministry here at Cornerstone. Next weekend, just want to give you a quick reminder, we are planning on our miracle offering next weekend, and we just want to challenge all of you to bring your best for Kingdom Builders and supporting all that goes on in that. So thank you for your help with that. Why don't we take a moment and let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity we have right now to partner with you in giving. Lord, that as we give back to you, Lord, there is such a difference that happens, such a change that happens for so many people. And God, we pray that difference would be an eternal difference, that people's hearts and people's lives would be changed for all of eternity. Father, we thank you that as we give, we are changed, and that it changes our hearts and who we are as well. And so, God, we pray that as we give today, that you would come alongside of it with your supernatural power and ability, multiply it, and use it to bring about life change as only you can. We ask this all in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen. God bless you. Thanks so much for your giving to the Lord through the ministry of Cornerstone Church this morning. Today, as we prepare to head into the message, first I'd like for us to take, would you help me out this morning, stand up where you're at, and we want to take a moment and pray. I just want to invite you just to reach your hands to the heavens with me right now, and as we pray today, there's a lot of hate in the world that we live in, and so we want to take a moment and pray for love. We want to pray for Jordan Love and the Green Bay Packers today. And so let's just lift our voices and our hearts and our hands. I'm kidding, sit down. I'm a terrible person. I'm a terrible pastor. But I just wanted to feel a little bit, just a little bit, like the Apostle Paul today when I preached, when he was being beaten and shouted down and insulted, and they had to whisk him out of the city over the wall in protection. And so I just feel a little more spiritual today, all right? You are much loved, all right? And you know what? We just need to move on. So let's watch this, the video today. Are you dialed? Are you ready to go? Are you dialed to make a difference? You know, I probably shouldn't say this, but during those last few moments there, that's probably the closest I've ever come to receiving the actual finger in church, and instead of the cornerstone finger. And so, boy, oh boy. Well, today we are here to get dialed. We are here to live a life that is dialed to make a difference in Jesus Christ. Amen? Do you want to be a believer that is dialed to make a difference in the name of Jesus Christ? Do you want to be a church that is dialed to make a difference in the name of Jesus Christ? That's how we are called to live. That's how we are called to follow Him. That's how we are called to invest our lives, to live dialed in Jesus Christ. That's how we are invited to live. And we've talked about this for the past month or so, and we started out on week one talking from John chapter 15, a number of verses there that we looked at, but this has kind of been the anchor verse for this collection of talks where Jesus speaks to us and he says, "This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples." And so Jesus is teaching us and he says, when we bear fruit with our lives, we are glorifying God and we are showing that we are his followers. We are his disciples. And there's an expectation on God's part that we would bear much fruit. And so we talked about the importance of remaining and taking time just to be in the presence of God. And we talked about on that first weekend about fruitfulness, and we talked last weekend about faithfulness and serving the Lord, and maybe you missed out on last weekend. There are Serving Fair guides that are available out in the lobby. You can check out different opportunities to invest your life in the local church and in this community that we live in, and so I invite you to check that out. And we didn't just talk about fruitfulness and faithfulness, but now today we're going to take some time and we're going to talk about fearlessness, living a fearless life in Jesus Christ. And Proverbs chapter 14, verse 26 tells us this, "In the fear of the Lord is strong confidence." This is how I want to live my life. This is one of the prayers that I pray for my own family. This is one of the prayers that I pray for our church, that we would live fearing God, not in a toxic, destructive fear, but in a constructive, holy. God is awe-striking. He is majestic. He is above all things. He is righteous and he is true. And he loves you today and he wants to live in and through your life. And so we want to live in the fear of God. We cried out in that song as we sang just a few moments ago. We lifted our voices and lifted our hands and said, "You are holy, God." That word holy means set apart. He's different from any other being. He's different than anything else. There's some pretty incredible things in this world that we live in. Creation is pretty amazing, but even creation itself is not worthy to be worshiped. God alone is worthy to be worshiped. And so we fear him. And when we fear him, we experience a confidence that is born not of ourselves, but it's born in Jesus Christ. And living in the fear of the Lord and in that strong confidence, somebody once said, when we fear God, then we'll fear nothing else. Because nothing else will take his place. Nothing else will be in an idolatrous place in our heart and in our life because we fear God and live in a strong confidence. We live fearlessly. There's a quote from Pastor Mark Batterson, who has written a number of books. I want to pull this up onto the screen here. He wrote a book called All In, and this is what he writes in there. Jesus didn't die to keep us safe. I'm just going to pause there, because that's jarring for us. Because we sometimes think, well, Jesus died on the cross so I can live a Minnesota nice life, and everything in my life can be put together and contained and have a nice bow on top. But Jesus didn't die to keep us safe. And we see this in the life of the early church. We're going to look at that in a moment, but I just want to draw attention to that very first line. Jesus didn't die to keep us safe. He died to make us dangerous. That's another interesting thought. Faithfulness is not holding the fort. It's storming the gates of hell. The will of God is not an insurance plan. It's a daring plan. The complete surrender of your life to the cause of Christ isn't radical. It's normal. It's time to quit living as if the purpose of life is to arrive safely at death. That is not the purpose of life. The purpose of life is to live fully alive in Jesus Christ. What are we about at Cornerstone Church? That's the finger I'm looking for today. One more, fully alive in Christ. And when we're living a life that's fully alive in Jesus Christ, we are bearing fruit. We are living a life that is dialed to make a difference. And so today, I want us to take these next few moments and talk through three areas that I want to challenge us in when it comes to living a fearless life. And so the first one is this: pray dangerously. If you're taking notes, that's the first fill-in in your notes. Pray dangerously. We often don't associate these two words together. We often pray for protection, and there's nothing wrong with that. But God invites us to pray dangerously. There's a passage in Acts chapter 4. It's in your notes and on the screen. It's, of course, in your Bible. And I want to just encourage you, when you go home today, at some point before the end of the day, to read Acts chapters 3 and 4 in your Bible, because they are rich chapters that kind of paint a picture for us of the early church, the New Testament church. And just to give you a little context before we read this passage, in Acts 3 and 4, Peter and John were preaching Jesus, who had just shortly before been crucified and then resurrected and then ascended to the heavens on the day of Pentecost after appearing for a number of weeks to a number of people, hundreds of people. He ascended to the heavens, and Peter and John were preaching Jesus, crucified, resurrected, the Savior of the world. And they were arrested, they were imprisoned. And as they were imprisoned, the religious high council, the Sanhedrin, called them in before them. And they said, you need to stop preaching in this name of Jesus. And they said, we won't. And they said, no, you don't understand. You need to stop preaching this name and this gospel of Jesus Christ, because if you continue, we're going to bring you in again. We're going to have you arrested, imprisoned, and beaten, and likely murdered, killed. And Peter and John looked at them. You see, this is when we fear God, we fear nothing else. This is in the fear of the Lord, there is a strong confidence. Because they looked at him and they said, this Jesus whom you crucified is Lord and Savior of the world. He is God, and we will follow him, and we will obey him and what he instructs us to do. We're not going to take orders from you. And the religious council is befuddled because they got pushback. They got pushback from these disciples, these followers of Jesus. And so they caucused and they said, what are we going to do? They're not listening to us. They're not obeying us. They're pushing back against what we're telling them to do. And nobody ever does that. And okay, so here's what we're going to do. Okay, guys, don't do this anymore. That's it. Leave. And they said, yes, we're leaving, and we're going to obey God. You see, these religious leaders who were attacking the gospel of Jesus Christ were rendered powerless in the midst of the fruit of a fearless life. And so Peter and John, they left and they went and they met with the others who were a part of the church at that point in time. And they started having a prayer meeting. And this was the prayer that was prayed in the early church prayer meeting. And when they had just been released from prison and told, if we catch you preaching this name again, we're going to imprison you and kill you. And this is what they prayed. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with all boldness. Can I tell you today that if David Simerson was praying this prayer after having just been released from prison for preaching the gospel, in my humanness, I would probably pray a different prayer. I'd be like, Lord, protect me. God, make a way of safety. God, let me never be arrested and go to prison again. But there's no mention in this whole prayer, if you look at the whole thing in Acts 4. There's no mention of prayer for protection. There's just a prayer that says, consider their threats, O God, and enable your servants to speak your word with what? With all boldness. Not some boldness, with all boldness. Do you know what this is, my friends? This is a dangerous prayer. Do you know what we can do with this? We can take this prayer into our week and we can begin to pray this prayer. Father God, enable your servants. Enable your servants to speak your word with all boldness. It's a good prayer for us to pray. Is there uncertainty on the other end of this prayer? 100%. But this is an important prayer. It's a good prayer. It's a dangerous prayer. And God invites us to pray dangerously if we're going to live fearlessly and fruitfully, dialed to make a difference for him. He calls us to this. He invites us to this. Would we pray dangerously? Would we pray, God, move me out of my comfort zone? Have you ever prayed prayers to move us out of our comfort? God, grow me and stretch me. God, give me a heart to serve you, to serve your church, to serve this community, to serve the world that I live in. God, give me a fire to share my faith with someone else, with one more person. God, give me a fire within me that can't be shut down to share my testimony with somebody else of the work that you're doing in my life, the work that you've done in my life, that you've forgiven me, you've freed me, you've restored me, and you are at work in me. And God, give me a fire that can't be shut down. God, give me a fire to step up and to be a group leader. God, give me a fire to step out and go on a serving trip, on a global trip to the inner city church of Minneapolis, or be a mentor at Minnesota Adult and Teen Challenge, or serve at Rachel's Hope, or serve in the preschool room at Cornerstone, or serve the students, or serve on a weekend and step out of my nice, tidy box, because Jesus didn't die for me to live a safe life. God, I pray that you give me the guts to step up and get baptized, because I know that I need to take that step. Jesus, you said yourself, believe and be baptized. And this is different than baby baptism, child dedication. This is a believer's baptism where we've placed our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And now we step up and step out and say, yes, Lord, I'll follow in your footsteps. It's really one of the first steps into a bold life. And so we pray, God, move me out of my comfort zone. I want to live boldly. I want to live fearlessly. And so what do? We pray dangerous prayers. And we see in Matthew chapter 9, Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. The next part of that verse. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. And then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask," now tune into this part. In fact, I'm going to go back again. The harvest is plentiful, Jesus says. I want us to hear this today. 42% of the world that we live in has no access to the gospel of Jesus. We can't quite grasp that because we have church, we have billboards, we have Christian TV, the whole deal. But there are 3 billion people around the world that don't have access to a Bible, a church, a missionary, a pastor, that don't have access to a Christian, nothing. They will be born and they will die without ever having heard the name of Jesus. The harvest is plentiful. But you see, the thing is, the workers are few. And so what does Jesus teach us to pray? Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. There are two workers that we support as a church, Andrew and Jenny. I won't say their last name, but they're in a hot zone. And a number of us who were a part of a virtual missions experience with them back in March. And they've had their children in the hot zone. They could have gone to a different country that was safer, that had far better conditions to give birth to their child, but they said, no, we want to have our children here because we want these people to know that this is our home. And so they are in a hot place that is super volatile, especially right now with everything that's happening in the Middle East. And this young couple, just maybe 6 or 7 years ago, they were living in a suburb of Minneapolis in Bloomington, and they were a part of a church that said, we want to send 10 missionaries from our church overseas. And so they got together with their small group and said, let's start praying for that. So they started praying, God, would you send missionaries? Would you raise up missionaries? We're asking you, would you raise them up and send them out from this church? And after a year and a half of praying in their group and praying personally, all of a sudden they sensed the Lord was speaking to them and saying, you're 2 of those 10 that I want to send from this church. And so They started walking through the process. They quit their jobs. And now they're on their second term in a hot zone. You see, they prayed dangerously. You say, well, Pastor Dave, I don't know if I want to pray dangerously. Yeah. It's scary. But we're invited, we're called, we're commanded, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into his harvest field, for the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. And so we can go in our prayers. In fact, you should have received one of these this morning with your notes when you walked in. It's our Kingdom Builders prayer list. And on this list, we have most of our global partners that we link arms with. And I want to challenge us to continue. We've done this in years past, to continue to pray for our missionaries. In fact, just something simple. Because 42% of the world has yet to hear the gospel, I want to just ask us, would we put this on our fridge? Would we put it in our Bible? Would we put it somewhere we're going to see it regularly? And daily, would we pray for 42 seconds for one of these global partners, for one of these regions and areas? There's a great resource online that you can also check out. If you're taking notes today, you can jot this down, joshuaproject.net. There's videos there. There's write-ups on lost people groups and nations, and it is a fantastic resource, joshuaproject.net. It will enhance your prayer life. But I want to challenge us to pray for 42 seconds a day for our partners because they are battling darkness. Say, Pastor Dave, 42 seconds a day, what's that going to amount to? Well, I like to think about this. How long does it take you to brush your teeth? Probably doesn't take you much more than 42 seconds, maybe 2 minutes. I don't know. I don't know what the dentist recommends. But anyways, 42 seconds. You know what? That short little habit that you have of brushing your teeth every day, it makes a difference over the long term. Can I get an amen? Yeah. You see, small things done over long periods of time can bring forth significant fruit. And so my challenge to us is to take 42 seconds a day and pray for our partners, and then one time a week, pray for 4 minutes and 20 seconds. You can do it however you want. Pray for one a day, pray for 10 a day, pray for one a day, and pray for a bunch at the end of the week with the 4 minutes and 20 seconds, whatever you want to do. If we pray for 42 seconds a day and 4 minutes and 20 seconds once a week, do you know that at the end of the year you will have invested 8 hours of your life in prayer for the lost in places that need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ? 8 hours in 1 year. Pray dangerously. Let me just ask you today, is there anything dangerous that you're praying for? The second area of challenge today is to give generously. In fact, I'll give you all the fill-ins right now. Pray, give, go. Give generously. Paul writes in Philippians chapter 4, and he says, I have received full payment and have more than enough. I am amply supplied now that I have received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent. So he's saying, you sent to support me, and now I'm amply supplied. These gifts that you sent, listen to this. Listen to what he says about the offering. They are a fragrant offering. And he's writing under the impulse of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is guiding him. They are a fragrant offering. You know how when you're brewing your coffee in the morning? You know when you drive-by Piggy Blues in the afternoon or evening. They are a fragrant offering to God. They are an acceptable sacrifice. This is what he says of our offerings. They are pleasing to God. When we give by faith in the name of Jesus, it is fragrant to him, it is acceptable to him, it is pleasing to him. You see, we talk all the time, God is worthy of our praise, he's worthy of our worship, he's worthy of our time, but you know what? God is also worthy of your money. Ooh, it's quiet. He's worthy of our money. And my God will meet all your needs according to his riches of glory in Christ Jesus. Now, I want to take a moment. I want to rewind a bit here. Oh, yeah. Verse 17. I was like, where is this? For even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent me aid, and more than once when I was in need, so he sent. Verse 17, not that I desire your gifts. Now listen to this part. What I desire is that more be credited to your account. My account? Your account. We have an account. We have an eternal account. When we give and live beyond ourselves, we are sending it ahead. We are investing in that eternal account. That's why Jesus gives the parable about the man who he just hoards and earns and hoards and earns. And then he tears down his barns to build bigger barns so that he can hoard more. And Jesus says, your wealth will perish with you. It will amount to nothing. But if we will send it on ahead, guess what? It'll be credited to our account. Just want that to settle with you and sit with us today for a moment. Because it's important for us to recognize that this life is not by any means all that there is. But most of us spend most of our life living as if this life is all there is. And then we look at the next piece here. I've received full payment and have more than enough. Oh, excuse me. Did we go through that already? I can't even remember. I'm all over the place. Let's go. This is the verse I'm looking for. Now, he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. So take note of this. The next verse tells us this. You will be enriched in every way. Why? So that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. Why will we be enriched? So that we can live generously on every occasion. So that God can be glorified in and through our lives. That we would be able to live generously, not just with our finance, but that there would be a generousness about the spirit of our life that would bring glory to God. So when it comes to giving dangerously, here are three keys. And this is the next thing that you see in your notes as well. Plan, vision, and dream. When it comes to our giving, I want to challenge you to plan your giving. I want to challenge you not to just leave your giving to happenstance, to, the offering is coming by and here's an extra $5 I've got in my wallet or a $20 or whatever the case may be. I want to challenge you to think about your giving, to plan your giving, to budget your giving, and see what God will do, because there will be times when you will deviate from that plan under the direction of the Holy Spirit. And we should give spontaneously when the Lord moves us to give, but we should also plan our giving, because you see, if we don't plan our giving, most of the time we will default to our human nature, which is based in selfishness. A long time ago, it was kids' church, preschool church actually, it's just the little toddlers, and Dan and Marion Greenemeyer were in class that day teaching, and they were teaching the kids about giving to missionaries, and they said, okay, we're going to receive an offering, and at that point, this was a long time ago, Pastor Corey's son, Jackson Getz, who didn't have two front teeth because he'd fallen down the steps and he had planted his two front teeth in the trim on the stairwell. And so he talked with a lisp and he didn't have two front teeth. And Jackson said, I'm not going to give my money to Jesus. I'm going to keep it all for myself. And then all of a sudden, all these toddlers rose up and they said, And there was this giant mutiny that happened in preschool church that day. We've had Dan and Marion in counseling ever since then. We checked them right into the stress unit. And he's a kid. When we're kids, we act like kids. When we're adults, when we're mature in our faith, then we begin to see. Then we begin to see, I'm on a mission. I'm expected to bear fruit and glorify my Father. My life is about Him. And so I'm going to give dangerously. I'm gonna plan. And I just want to just encourage you today to plan your giving. We've been challenging us as a church to plan for next week's miracle offering for Kingdom Builders. Our goal is big, $900,000. And nobody here has to give. But we're invited to give. Giving and tithing is not a salvation issue. It's a stewardship issue. Jesus invites us into a life of honoring Him with our financial resource. Why? So that He can fill our lives more. Giving is a gateway. So that He can fill our lives with whole life blessings. So that He can change our hearts. Because Jesus teaches and He says, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. And I want my heart to be directed towards Him. So I'm going to put my treasure towards Him. And so He instructs us in the Word. In Malachi, bring the whole tenth into the storehouse and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out blessing in your life. And I have found this to be the case in my own life, that when I honor the Lord with the first 10%, the first tenth of what I've received for my time and my talents and my labors, that when I do that, that He does so much more in my life. And He does so much more through my life. You see, I've experienced a lot of blessing in my life. And I am completely convinced that God can do so much more in my finances with 90% than I can do in my own life with 100% of my finances. I just give Him that first 10. And then I say, Lord, that first 10, I return that back to You. If You want any of the rest of this, You let me know. And that's what my Kingdom Builder's giving is. It's the rest. I say, You have access, Lord. And so then I plan on giving to Kingdom Builders, and I give to Kingdom Builders monthly, and then I give to Kingdom Builders in the miracle offering. That's my plan. And so we're invited to bring tithes to the Lord And then after we bring that first tenth, then we can bring offerings and we say, Lord, what else do you want to do? We have a plan. And I want to encourage us to plan our giving. I want to encourage us to have a vision for our giving. You see, the plan is the plan goal, but then the vision is the stretch goal. God, what could you do through me? How do you want to stretch me in this? That's also Kingdom Builders giving. How do you want to stretch me in this? It's the stretch goal. And then there's a dream, the dream goal. And you know what the dream goal is? It's a ridiculous goal. God, is there a ridiculous number that you have that you want me to give at some point that I can start praying about? And it's just between me and you, and if I've got a mate, my mate. But is there a ridiculous dream goal? God, let's start working towards the vision goal, and let's start working towards the dream goal. We plan, we vision, we dream. And so next weekend, I'm inviting you, I'm encouraging you, I'm challenging you. Be here. We're going to have Justin and Tara Mack with us, one of our partners. They're the founders of Project 42 that focuses exclusively on the limited and no access regions of the world with the gospel. You will be glad you came to church next weekend. We're going to receive the miracle offering. Come and be with us. If you aren't going to be here, I encourage you, you can give online. You can send in a check. You can stop in and drop it off. But let's plan and let's vision and let's dream. Let's plan, let's stretch, let's be ridiculous in our faith. Is there anything dangerous about our giving today? And the last thing, if we're going to live fearlessly, we pray, we give, and we go. We pray, we give, and we go. We pray, we give, and we go dangerously. We go dangerously. That's the last fill-in in your notes. And as we think about going dangerously, there's a passage of scripture in Matthew chapter 28, verse 19. Therefore, Jesus says, go. Therefore, go. Go. And if you look at this word go in the original Greek language, it means go. It means don't stay. Therefore, go and make disciples of every nation. And that word in the original language actually means it's the word ethnos, every ethnicity, every people group, every language, every ethnicity, every people group. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Go means don't stay. And so go in your prayers, go in your giving, go in your going. Move out of our comforts. Step out into the unknown because Jesus didn't die for us to live a safe life. There are opportunities that we have. November 1st, this Wednesday night, we're going to have an Israel and Middle East prayer gathering, prayer time, right here in this room, 7 o'clock to 8:30. I invite you to come out. It's great for young adults. It's great for every age. It's great if you want to just gain some understanding on what's happening there, because we're going to talk about that, and we're going to pray about what's happening in the Middle East, because we need to pray. We need to pray. And so that's happening this Wednesday, 7 to 8:30 p.m. And then we have what I already talked about, the miracle offering next weekend. And then after that, the next thing that we see is the 10th. We have the Inner City Church of Minneapolis street team. We're going to meet here at 4:30. We're going to drive up to the Inner City Church of Minneapolis in South Minneapolis. We're going to take a moment to pray together. And then we're going to break up into teams with the others who are gathered there on that night. And we're going to go out on the streets of South Minneapolis with hot dogs, and we're going to offer people a warm hot dog on a cold day and say, is there anything we can pray with you about? And then we're going to listen, and then we're going to pray. And you might say, well, I've never prayed out loud before. I don't know how to pray. It's okay. Come on along. You'll be paired up with somebody else on your team who's okay with praying out loud. It's a good way for you to learn, and it's a good way for you to get out of your comfort zone. And here's what I'll guarantee you. There's no safety involved. There's no safety involved. I can't guarantee you that you're going to be safe. But you can come. And you can hand out a hot dog and you can say a prayer. We've had teams up there before. Is it scary or violent? I don't know that anybody's been scared. But we never know what's going to happen. We don't know what's going to happen in Austin, Minnesota. We don't know what's going to happen in Cornerstone Church. Can I get an amen on that? Street team, November 18th, the Inner City Church of Minneapolis Thanksgiving Outreach. We have 9 spots left for that. That's happening on that date at those times. It's the Saturday before Thanksgiving. And we feed people, and there's kids ministry, and so we've got 9 spots. You can sign up on the app. It's first come, first serve. And then February 3rd, it's the work and demo team day. We helped ICCM purchase their discipleship house in the last 2 years. It's right next to their church building. And we've gone up and sent teams in and done demo. And so we're gonna work on the building again. Whatever work they have for us to do, we're going to do that. And then May 2024, Eswatini Africa Global Trip. And there are some packets out on the Info Center if you're interested in that. But these ICCM opportunities you can sign up for on the app. And those are opportunities to go. Jesus didn't die to keep us safe. I'm going to invite you to watch the screen together with me.
This is the reality in the world. Over 3 billion people being born and living and dying without ever hearing about God's love in Jesus. And this is a problem. Like, surely this is not tolerable for us. I don't understand why we in the church are not talking about this all the time. Like, why would we not be talking about this all, and not just at a missions conference, like all the time? 3 billion people? It's not that they've heard the gospel and rejected it. They've never even heard it. God's been gracious to us and blessed us and caused his face to shine upon us in so many ways so that his ways may be known on earth and his saving power known among the nations. We should be talking about this all the time. And not just talking about it, doing something about it. We're just turning a functional deaf ear and blind eye to this reality. What did Jesus say? Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So where's our treasure? The reality is we spend most of our money on ourselves in one of the wealthiest places to ever exist on planet Earth, making life more comfortable for us. This has got to change. The number of unreached people is higher now than ever before in history, and it will continue to increase until Christians decide to follow Jesus fully. We are following a nice, comfortable Christian spin on an American dream that's turning a deaf ear and a blind eye to billions of people who need the gospel. and we call it Christianity. And it's not. It's not biblical Christianity. Biblical Christianity involves followers of Jesus making disciples who make disciples of the nations. Every single follower of Jesus saying, how are we going to get the gospel together to those who've never heard it?
Stand with me if you would. And this time, I'm actually asking, would you lift your hands? Would you close your eyes? And we're just going to take a moment. We talked a few weeks ago about remaining. Jesus says, remain in me, and I'll remain in you, and you will bear much fruit. We're just going to take a moment of quiet. Just remain and let the Spirit of God speak to us. Just hear what he's calling you into, how he's calling you to act, because he's a God of action. Heavenly Father, today we come to you with our hands up and our hearts saying, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. And we want to be people of action, like our God is a God of action. And we want to bear much fruit, give you glory. And so today we pray that you would speak to us. What is it that you're challenging us in? Is it in our prayers? Adding a dangerous prayer to our daily prayer time? Adding dangerous giving to our budget? To our dream? Adding dangerous going to our life? Step out of our comfort zone. Lord, today we pray that there would be a download of your Spirit into our lives as we reach to you, and that we would be a people who follow you fully and who have a heart that all nations will hear and know the name of Jesus, and that you'd be glorified. Every people group, every language, every tongue. Lord, today we pray that we would not sit and waste the lives that you've entrusted to us. If we've placed our faith in Christ, we're saved. But we're going to give an accounting for the resources of our life, our time, our talents, our treasures. And so we want to live lives that reflect you in the way that all of our life is. And we're gonna be imperfect, and we're gonna fail, and you're gonna forgive us. But God, we want to be faithful managers and stewards. We want you to have the glory. So we trust you today. You can put your hands down with eyes closed, heads bowed, for any of us today who say, you know what, Dave, I need to trust my life in Jesus and become one of his followers, become a Christian. Receive forgiveness from my sin. Receive peace. Be washed. And be filled. And be sent. Let's all pray this prayer together across this room. Let's pray it loud and strong right now. Pray this with me. Dear Jesus, I come to you. I've sinned. You are perfect. You died in my place and rose from the grave. I believe it and I trust you. I give you my life. I turn from my sin. Forgive me. Thank you for your life. Live in me from this day forward. Jesus, we pray these things today in the greatest name. Amen. Amen. Today, if you made that decision to trust your life in Christ, welcome to the family of God, which is so much bigger than Cornerstone Church. If you did that, if you're online, you can text the word decided to the number that's on the screen. Otherwise, if you're here in person right outside this set of doors, there's a counter to the left with a bunch of these books. It's a New Testament Bible for those who are new to faith in Christ. Take one of these with you. Begin to open it up and read it. And let Jesus change your life. Whether you're new or you've been here 100 times, keep coming back. We want to be part of your journey of growing in Christ. You are much loved. Thanks for being with us at Cornerstone Church today. God bless you. Go with God. He goes with you.
This is your prayer, your declaration.